So let's move on first to the introduction. The introduction, what it is that it's an overview of the research topic and the problem. And allowing an overview, okay, allows the reader to imagine themselves as part of the topic. They're part of the topic, somehow, if they imagine, they could somehow feel, you know, how it feels like. And with this feeling, there are emotions involved, there are thinking involved, and there are buy-ins. And you could do that, which is a very, very good overview of the topic. As we've discussed in the past, as I mentioned, the first 10 words of your writing attracts 90% of your target audience. Now, in this case, of course, the intro is not made of 90 of 10 words only, right? The first few lines that you say in an introduction can help determine if this will be something of interest for them. You know, interesting. In this case, you know, may not immediately be informative. Okay, interesting may not immediately be informative. Well, interesting is actually more inviting and intriguing. If you could invite them and intrigue them with the very first lines of your introduction, that says a lot. Okay, it states the study's objective. You know, almost immediately after the topic is presented. Within the introduction, you know, the problem is often stated, the topic, and then the problem. Now, if there's a problem and there's an objective right after, you know, you don't leave people off a cliffhanger. An objective and a problem, if they read it in an almost seamless paragraph, allows them to make it feel urgent, important for them, you know, also making it more compelling for them to read, right? So it states the study's objective, making it important and urgent, and more importantly, relevant for the reader. The introduction previews the thesis structure. Now, from the very short introduction that you do, you gave the what the topic is, how it affects the stakeholders, how it affects the context. You can also include statistics, you know, to preview some sort of structure. Statistics from the past, from the present, local to global, since we're talking about structure. How the topic looked like a couple of years ago to now, how it looks like globally, how it looks like locally. You know, where to start, how it looked like, and how it end if it's potentially not addressed. And in the introduction, you have the opportunity, you know, to convince your reader why the topic is important. Just think of it this way. Without a proper introduction, it's like watching a movie from the middle already. Now, even though in the middle there's a lot of action going on, the rising point to the climax, main character development going on, we don't even care because we didn't even get to understand where these characters, how the story begin with. What is the main problem? To be exact. Or worse, you know, if you watch a movie from end to start, imagine like watching Star Wars and you already know who Darth Vader is, he's Luke's father, or watching the Avengers and you know that Tony Stark will die, you know, it loses its overall impact, especially if you're spoiled. So again, a good introduction doesn't have to be very long, it should be very short and sweet, and it's an opportunity for you to convince the reader why is it very important. Now, the rationale or the rationale, right? Whatever part of the world you are right now explains the significance of the study, you know, explains the study's necessities, show why the research is needed. Some formatting may call it as the significance of the study itself, you know, your research has to be answering something, you know. It can be a new question or an old one in the past with a new context. It can be capitalizing on new opportunities that are coming up, or it could be handling present and future threats, you know. So the rationale shows this. So even if it's a basic research, nothing is really basic if you tell the audiences why you're doing it. What's the bigger picture when the basic research is done? Now, if this is action research, you have to state who, what, where, and the findings are applied. You know? Right. So it explains the study's necessity, shows why your research is needed. You know, are there any new trends or old questions unanswered? It identifies knowledge gaps, highlights what's missing and existing interesting studies. Are there any previous gaps and results or new gaps? And a good rationale justifies the research approach. Your goal is to connect the study to broader academic or practical contexts. Are there opportunities we made or immediate threats? Just think of it this way. A good rationale is like selling to someone. You're trying to convince someone to buy in. Buy-in doesn't necessarily mean putting in monetary resources, but buying in involves putting in some resources. What are these resources? Time, emotions, even their care about the topic is buying in. So a good rationale is selling to someone, you influencing your readers to participate, to buy in, to give a care, if not their resources, but their time and even their emotions on your topic. But then again, writing the introduction and rationale may sound simple, okay, as I illustrated, but it's not, especially for beginners, and it wasn't easy even for me. Now, for example, I used to write 10-page introductions wherein I dump all my ideas from the get-go, the opportunity I have. And you'll realize as you move along, there's a time and place for that. They call that as the review of related literature. That's where you try to put in as much information as you can. But when we're talking about the introduction, you know, where your goal is to convince your reader why the topic is important, your goal in the rationale is to influence your readers to buy in. An introduction that tries to say a lot may not be saying anything at all. An introduction that fails to define the variables fails to define the scope. You know, it loses the reader's attention. In some cases, as I mentioned, overwhelming the reader and the variables fails to make the audience see the connection. In introduction and rationale, there has to be a short and sweet length for a good introduction. And most of you will observe in looking at previous theses that as much as possible, it's only 2 to 3 pages, a good introduction. Okay? Same goes with rationale. If you talk too much, then you mean very little. You know, a good rationale must immediately identify the gap, the relevance, what happens when the theory is practiced, and so on. You will also observe that rationale in theses are mostly 1 to 2 pages only. Right, so the game of introduction and rationale is to make it short but sweet, simple and significant. And for us to do that, I made this simple guideline for you to tactically choose the right words to craft your intro and rationale. There's a very quick guideline. I made it even color-coded for you, for me to help you determine if you have the right amount of sentences for every structure of your introduction. So we have the thesis title online. You introduce what the topic is by explaining what the IV is, the DB, the importance of the research gaps, and the rationale. As you would notice, there's a certain number of sentences that you could put in. But then again, these are guidelines wherein you could also you know, you could do more. You could improve if you want to, whatever suits your needs. But as much as possible, as I mentioned, a good intro and a good rationale has to be short and sweet, simple, but significant. So this structure, you know, is organized, focused into sections, is very thorough as much as I can, covers key aspects like the independent variable, the DB, the research graphs. It promotes an analysis, you know, critical thinking with targeted questions for you to answer. Of course, there are cons with every structure. It's oversimplified. Sometimes you can't briefly explain the idea in the DB, especially if it's very broad, you know. And as you would also observe in writing, there will be some redundancies, especially in the context and stakeholder impact. It might feel repetitive, but it's part of it. It's very inflexible if you also follow a structure. But then again, having a good guideline is good for beginners such as you guys. Right, so this is one example, no? Working on the thesis title, I wrote down the introduction to the topic, explained what the idea is in the DB. And for those of you who don't know by now, as I am making this recording, I am also writing my own research with my class. I am teaching this class of thesis to 26 students, and I wanna get down on the trenches. I wanna get down with the trenches. If they're doing the war fighting, I wanna be with them. I just don't want to be the person who's commanding. So, to do that, I'm also doing my research. And the title of my research is Evaluating the Impact of Online Learning on the Practical Skills and Real Life Application for Thesis and Working Students. So those are you guys. Okay? So here na nga. I briefly explain what the IB is, no? In this case, the IB is impact of online learning and practice. And impact of online learning would find it this way. Change practically. Turn to online platforms. It becomes crucial to evaluate these methods and cause practices application. So if you would look at this sentence structure, I've briefly explained what the IB is, online learning, and I briefly explained what the DB is, you know? Again, it's up to you how you would want to structure the sentence. As much as possible, make it short and sweet. Here's the next line. The importance of research. I briefly narrowed down to two to three sentences. And in this case, I've explained what the relationship of the IB and the DB is. How does the relationship impact the context? And how does the relationship impact the stakeholders? Of course, when you mention these, you have to also include the references, no? So you just have to follow the structure, you know, you may not. Again, this is just me writing. You could have your own way. Pwedeng mauna ang isa over the other. Pero I like following the structure. Just for me, ha? For me applying this research. For me to have a structure in doing it. For me to have a structure in teaching it as well. Of course, identify the research gap. Nothing provides more urgency and importance if you provide data. Okay? You can provide global statistics, how the IB and the DB look like globally. You could provide local. Of course, if your study is pertaining to one country or group, you provide local statistics. You could give direct quotations from significant people. Okay? People who are pioneers in the field that you're trying to study. In this research gap, you're trying to make, you know, again, as mentioned, importance and urgency for the readers to understand and to buy in, right? So this is just an example. No, I'm sure that you could make your own global statistics, which also includes statistics from CHED, you know, local statistics, which also include from EdTech. Oh, and that's interchangeable. I'm sorry. Local statistics that came from CHED, global statistics that come from EdTech, and that's it. Now, moving on to the rationale. With rationale, you try to make it short, as I mentioned. You try to make it very impactful by directly going to what are the new trends, what are the new knowledge gap. Are there opportunities to be made? Are there trends if not resolved? For example, what are the new trends? You know, as new technological modalities and trends are being incorporated in school, these are the new trends. No? What are the knowledge gap? There still exist knowledge gaps, particularly in the Philippines, especially in online learning. Now, are there opportunities to be made? For this example, I directly put in the words. Trends, gaps, opportunities, and threats. Then there are opportunities to be made that improve online learning practices and better support students. Are there threats if not resolved? Again, it's already situated here. We're not in the city proper. Then the failure in the part of academics is to provide quality education in terms of equipping their students. Okay. So I narrowed it down, broke it down, broke down the rationale, okay, to make it more urgent and important. So if you follow that structure, you know, an introduction and rationale would look like this. So again, this is my writing as of this video, right? Me working with my students. This is how it looked like for now. And you know, this photo is size 9 in single space, but if you double space it, depending on the requirements, it will make for a good 3 to 4 pages of your thesis. Now, this is important for me because it sets title, it sets the guide, the intro, the rationale sets up the importance and the urgency of your topic. And it's still written in an academically and not in a dramatic fashion. So, okay, that was very simple. I want to simplify the art and science of writing thesis. So it has to be very simple. And I hope that you find it very simple. In our next videos, we'll be discussing on how to make the conceptual map and the theoretical.